Professor Dave here. I want to teach you the Gram-Schmidt process.
He knows a lot about all kinds of stuff, Professor Dave explains.
In the previous tutorial, we learned all about orthogonal vectors and how we can generate from these a set of orthonormal vectors by taking each vector and dividing it by its length. This makes each vector's length equal to 1, and since they were already orthogonal, the new vectors become orthonormal. But what if we start with a set of vectors that are not already orthogonal? Furthermore, how do we go about making an orthonormal basis for a vector space, given any set of vectors that form a basis? To do this, we need to learn something called the Gram-Schmidt process. So let's take a look at this now. To see how this works, let's examine the vectors v1 to vn, which serve as a basis for the vector space V. Our only requirement for these vectors is that they form a basis. We are no longer assuming any orthogonality between them. The Gram-Schmidt process takes these vectors and forms a new orthogonal set of basis vectors, which we will label u1 to un. The process goes as follows. First, start by setting the first new vector, u1, equal to the first basis vector, v1. For the second step, take the second vector, v2, and subtract from it the inner product between v2 and u1, divided by the length of u1 squared, times the vector u1. So altogether, that looks like this. Then the third step will be to take the vector v3 and subtract a similar term. The only difference is that now we take the inner product between v3 and u1 in the numerator. And then we also subtract another term, which is the inner product between v3 and u2, divided by the length of u2 squared times u2. At this point, you may notice a pattern emerging. For each new vector, we must subtract an additional term that involves the inner product of the current v vector with each previously found u vector. So we will need one more such term for each vector. The reason we need to do this is that we are subtracting off any part of the v vector that is not orthogonal to the new vectors we have found, leaving only the orthogonal part. To make things a little more succinct, each of these new vectors, after the first one, can be put into summation notation as follows. Uk equals vk minus the sum over I from 1 to k minus 1 of the inner product between vk and ui, divided by the length of ui squared times ui. If this notation is unfamiliar, go back and check out some of my tutorials on sums. Otherwise, we can quickly see how the orthogonal basis we just wrote can be derived from this expression. Some useful tips to help remember how this looks include noting that the only v vector that appears in the formula has the same number as the u that is being found. Also, every other u vector that has already been found will show up in a specific term in the remaining v vectors. Another helpful feature is that u1 has one term in its formula. u2 has two. u3 has three, and so on. For ordinary real vectors, what we mean by inner product is simply the vector dot product. And recall that the length of a vector is simply the square root of its dot product with itself. So just considering this case, we can rewrite these terms with dot products. This might all look a bit overwhelming at first glance, but let's look at an example and take it step by step. Consider the basis vectors for R3, v1 equals 1, negative 1, 1, v2 equals 1, 0, 1, and v3 equals 1, 1, 2. We always start by setting our first vector u1 equal to the first basis vector, so u1 equals 1, negative 1, 1. Now we get to step 2, where we take our second vector, v2, and subtract v2.u1 divided by u1.u1 times u1. Well, v2.u1 will be 1 times 1 plus 0 times negative 1 plus 1 times 1, or simply 2. Then u1.u1 will be 1 times 1 plus negative 1 times negative 1 plus 1 times 1, or 3. So u2 equals 1, 0, 1 minus 2/3 times 1, negative 1, 1. Simplifying this expression, we get u2 equals 1/3, 2/3, 1/3. Finally, for the third vector, u3, we will take v3 minus v3.u1 over u1.u1 times u1 minus v3.u2 over u2.u2 times u2. Now simplifying, v3.u1 is 1 times 1 plus 1 times negative 1 plus 2 times 1, which is 2. We already know that u1.u1 is 3, so let's just use that. Then v3.u2 is 1 times 1/3 plus 1 times 2/3 plus 2 times 1/3, which equals 5/3. And then u2.u2 is 1/3 times 1/3 plus 2/3 times 2/3 plus 1/3 times 1/3, which becomes 1/9 plus 4/9 plus 1/9. This is 6/9, which simplifies to 2/3. Plugging in all these dot products, we get u3 equals 1, 1, 2, minus 2/3 times 1, negative 1, 1, minus 5/3 over 2/3, which simplifies to 5/2, times 1/3, 2/3, 1/3. Lastly, going through the vector addition, we end up with u3 equals negative 1/2, 0, 1/2. These three vectors form an orthogonal basis. Now, if we wanted an orthonormal basis, as we know, we would take each of these resultant vectors and do what we have already learned, dividing each vector by its length, thus creating a new set of vectors of length 1. And since they are already orthogonal, these vectors will be orthonormal. To be thorough, let's go ahead and do this for the three vectors we just found. u1 equals 1, negative 1, 1, u2 equals 1/3, 2/3, 1/3, and u3 equals negative 1/2, 0, 1/2. We know that u1.u1 equals 3, so the length of u1 is root 3. We also saw that u2.u2 was 2/3, so the length of u2 is root 2/3. We must still calculate u3.u3, which ends up being negative 1/2 times negative 1/2, plus 0 times 0, plus 1/2 times 1/2, which equals 1/2. So the length of u3 is root 1/2. Now, taking u1 and dividing by its length, we get 1 over root 3, negative 1 over root 3, 1 over root 3. Taking u2 and dividing by its length, we get 1 over root 6, 2 over root 6, 1 over root 6. Finally, dividing u3 by its length, we get negative root 2 over 2, 0, root 2 over 2. These are the orthonormal basis vectors we obtain from our original basis, thanks to the Gram-Schmidt process. Being able to generate an orthonormal basis is a useful tool, as the bases themselves can be very helpful for certain calculations. This process also works for different kinds of vector spaces, such as ones involving functions. It just changes how we compute the inner product. Now that we've gone over the process of finding an orthonormal basis from any existing basis vectors, let's check comprehension. Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.